Hello, I'm Anil Zabitakis, and I'm going to talk about more revenue from two samples via factored given SDPs. And this is going to work with Konstantinos Daskalakis. In the single item CD buyer auction setting, the value of the buyer for the item is drawn for some distribution f. It is a classical assumption in this setting that the seller knows the distribution f, but doesn't know the realized value v that is drawn from f, which is only known to the buyer. A celebrated result by Meyerson states that the optimal mechanism in this setting is a post-price mechanism, where the seller posts a price X star and lets the buyer decide whether they are willing to pay X star to get the item or not. The optimal price X star can also be easily computed maximizing the product X times one minus f of X, where f here denotes the cumulative density function of the distribution f. One important issue that we have to resolve in order to apply this mechanism is how the seller learns the value distribution f. Towards answering this question, a recent line of work in computer science and economics tackles the problem of learning approximately optimal mechanisms given only sample access to the distribution f. As a result, we know how many samples are needed in order to learn approximately optimal mechanisms in the data-rich regime where we have plenty of samples available. In this work, we focus on the data-poor regime, which is not well understood yet. In the data pool regime, we are interested in whether reasonably good mechanisms can be identified from only a small number of samples from the distribution f. This is a practically relevant regime since it's important to design online ad auctions. In these applications, although the total number of auctions available is huge, if we restrict our attention to auctions with similar features, then our past observations are very few. In the extreme of the data pool regime, when only one sample from M is available, a geometric argument back to 2010 shows that if F is a regular distribution, then given just one sample from F, we can extract at least half of the optimal revenue. Follow-up work has also shown that this is optimal for deterministic mechanisms, while will work very few at all, so that this can be slightly improved via randomization. The question that we're trying to ask to answer in this work is, can we do better given two samples from the distribution? This question has been proven very challenging, and only very recently it has been shown that the empirical revenue mechanism with two samples achieves at least 0.509 times the optimum, which proves a separation between the case of one sample and two samples. Nevertheless, the analysis in this work is very, very challenging and tedious. In this work, we develop a general framework for analyzing the revenue attainable by mechanisms that are designed using only a few independent samples from F. Our framework is based on semi-definite programming and can be applied in abstract settings to evaluate the performance of some policy that is chosen using only a few dependent samples from a distribution, and then the performance of this policy is tested on a fresh sample from the same distribution. Our first result is that a rounded version of the empirical revenue maximization mechanism with two samples attains a revenue that's approximately 0.56 times the optimum when the distribution f is regular. And this is improves our state of the art knowledge about how much revenue we can extract from two samples. We also prove a lower bound by providing a regular distribution f under which the empirical revenue maximization mechanism from two samples cannot do better than 0.642 times the optimum. Now, I'll first describe the empirical revenue maximization mechanism and its rounded version that we analyze in this paper. Then, I will briefly explain the main ideas of how to build our semi-definite relaxation. Let me start with the empirical revenue maximization. The empirical revenue maximization mechanism is a positive price mechanism, where the reserve price is computed based on the two samples that we have, V1 and V2. Namely, the reserve price is equal to the optimal reserve price when the actual distribution of samples is equal to the empirical distribution that we observed. In other words, it's a uniform distribution over the set V1, V2. To define the rounded version of the ERM, we first need gridding of the positive real line. For this reason, we define the set of points T rho that is equal to all the possible positive and negative powers of the number rho, that's a number that's greater than one. Then, for every real value x, we define the rounded value g rho of x, that is the largest element of g rho that is less than x. The discretization that we use looks something like this. The reserve price of the rounded ERN is then equal to the reserve price of the ERN, but with inputs not V1, V2, but the rounded versions of V1 and V2. Let now opt F be the optimal revenue for some given distribution F. We define the approximation ratio alpha star of ERM to be equal to the minimum possible ratio between the revenue that ERM achieves and the optimal possible revenue for this distribution, and the minimum is taken over all the distributions that are regular. The same way, we define the alpha star rho, which is the approximation ratio of the rounded ERM. Our goal in this work is to find bounds on the alpha star and alpha star rho. Let me now briefly explain our FDP relaxation that we use in order to find the lower bound of the approximation ratio alpha star rho. Our first step is to express the ratio alpha star rho as a solution of an optimization program. Our program looks as follows. Our values that we optimize over are the distribution F, the value of the optimum, and the value of the optimal reserve price, for which the optimal revenue is achieved. The objective function is then equal to the revenue that the rounded ERM achieves when the input follows the distribution F. Our program has also some constraints, and in particular, that F should be regular, and the fact that the revenue for this distribution is exactly optimum, so it's at most optimum for any price and at least optimum for the price P star. So these two guarantee that the optimal revenue is opt and is achieved at the price P star. In the interest of time, I won't carefully describe the optimization program formulation, but as an example, I will present the idea of how to express the regularity constraints. To define the regularity constraints, we need first to define the notion of the revenue curve. The revenue curve RF of a function F takes as input a value Q in 0, 1, and outputs a value, the value 1 minus Q times F to the minus 1 of Q, where F to the minus 1 means the inverse function. Then the distribution F is said to be regular if and only if the revenue curve is a Kokeve function. To express regularity constraints, we add the constraint for every real number x, y, and every number z between x and y. The constraint that we add ensures that the value of the revenue curve at z is above the line that intersects the revenue curve at x and y, as it's shown in this picture. So this is how we design the regularity constraints, and similarly, we can design the objective function and the optimality constraints. Hence, we conclude with an optimization program that looks like this. The exact expression is not important for the purpose of this presentation, but this is how it looks like. Here is the objective function, here are the regularity constraints, and here these two are the optimality constraints. The variables of this program is the distribution F. Here with small f, we denote the probability density function of distribution F. And with capital F, we denote the cumulative density function of F. Also, a variable is the optimal that corresponds to the optimal revenue, and the price P star of the optimal reserve price. The main problem with this program is although it is exactly equal to the approximation ratio, it is an infinitely dimensional and an infinitely sized program, so it's very hard to solve. For this reason, we now introduce some relaxations that provide only a lower bound of the approximation ratio, so we will lose the exact equality, but are easier to solve. So the first relaxation is discretization. So our first step is to replace the continuous set of variables with a discrete set of variables. We do this by considering a coarser representation of the distribution F. That is, we only consider the variables Fi that should be thought as the probability that a sample that is drawn from F lies in the interval rho to the I, comma rho to the I plus 1. Using this discrete set of variables, we can define the relaxation alpha rho of I star I out that has the advantage that the number of variables and the number of constraints are only countably many because we have replaced R with Z here. But this optimization problem is still infinite, although it's countably infinite, so it's still very difficult to solve. So for this reason, we introduce an extra relaxation that we truncate all the variables and all the constraints to lie inside the interval M minus M plus of some positive integers. The number of these integers in this interval is equal to n, and this is a hyperparameter of our optimization program together with the random parameter draw. Additionally, to simplify this program, we drop the variables opt and p star that we had before, and we replace them with the discrete version, which is rho to the I opt and rho to the I star. So now the parameters are I star and I opt. For our final bound, we only consider the minimum value of this optimization program for all the set of parameters I opt and I star. So we drop this I star and I opt from variables of this program, and we consider them as parameters, and we have one different program for any combination of these two variables. And we consider these two variables to have again range in m plus, m minus m plus. So now the good thing is that we have a finitely dimensional program with finitely many number of constraints. Unfortunately, this problem is still difficult to solve because both the objective function and the constraints are non-convex. This happens because of the presence of these products of variables, and these products of variables appear because of our assumption that the two samples from F and the test sample are all dependent from each other. So here's the main idea of this paper to overcome this final difficulty. We replace the vector of variables Fi with a three-dimensional tensor of variables Fi, Jk. Using this relaxation, we drop the assumption that we have dropped the assumption that all the samples are independent from each other. Now we replace every appearance of the product Fi of JFK with the variable Fi JK. Also, we replace the product Fi times Fj with the summation over k of Fi JK, and the same for Fi. One very important detail for our relaxation is that every constraint that contains only the variables of the all product Fi Fj or only variables Fi, we replace it with the set of constraints where we use Fijk in place of Fi times Fj, and we repeat the same constraint for all values of k, and in the case of Fi, we repeat this for all values of j and k. So doing this, the relaxation that we describe is a linear program, so it's very easy to solve. Unfortunately, using this bound, we get a very bad bound, and it's useless. For this reason, we strengthen our relaxation by adding the SDP constraints that for all I, the matrices Fi that are equal to Fi Jk for all the values of Jk are positive definite. Observe that these constraints are trivially satisfied when Fi Jk is equal to the product Fi times Fj times Fk. Hence, our final problem is indeed a relaxation of the initial program. So this is our final SDP relaxation, and we have also dropped the parameter IO because we can prove that we can set it to some value that depends only on rho at n. So we get this set of SDP programs, one for every value of I star with hyperparameters rho and n. We call the solution to one particular program alpha bar rho comma n of I star. Our main theoretical result is the approximation ratio alpha star rho is lower bounded by this constant that depends on rho and is n times the minimum of this set of programs. Hence, if we find solution to the SDP programs for any rho, for any choice of rho and n, we can get immediately a rho bound on alpha star rho. To solve these SDP programs, we use the packet CVXPy that calls the solver SCS. And the solver SCS produces not only a solution to the primal, but also a solution to the dual program. Hence, the value of the dual variables provide a proof for the lower bound that we have find about the value of alpha bar rho n of I star. For the hyperparameters, we use rho equal to 1.08 and n equals to 100. And we get the result that this lower bound is equal to 0.558. We refer to the implementation code and the values of the dual variables, where you can check the validity of our solution in this GitHub repository. So to summarize, the important ideas of this paper is to replace the product measure that appears in the objective function and the constraints with a higher order tensor and add the corresponding SDP constraints. Also, as I said, the important idea is where we replace the appearance of Fi or Fi times Fj to replace them with, in the constraints, to replace them with Fi jk and take the, repeat the constraints for all j and k or for all k. And the final very important idea for this program to work is to use logarithmic grading of the space. Some future directions are to apply this framework to other problems but that have the same nature, so that they have a few dependent samples from transient distribution, and we want to minimize or maximize overall possible distributions. And it is to do this by relaxing the product measures to higher order tensors using SDP constraints. I hope this can find more application in game theory mechanics design, but also in problems in gaming theory. And the second future direction is to actually understand theoretically the dual of the SDP program that we construct to get results for better gradings of the states for which we don't have enough computational power. So to find the solutions of SDP when rho is smaller and n discretization is larger. Thank you.